So what are you doing?
Nothing.
Nothing? Why not?
I'm trying to get on this Lifestyle Radio website.
Sounds like a cool website.
Yeah, it's alright. Oh, wait, I might have it.
You might have it.
You're listening to Lifestyle Radio.
The opinions expressed during this show are those of the individual participants and do not necessarily reflect the opinions of their associated organizations or Lifestyle Radio.
What's the matter with that cat there?
Must be full of reefer.
Full of reefer?
Yeah, man.
Mean that cat's high?
Sailing.
Sailing?
Lightly.
We now wander off the beaten path with an update from the Reefer Reporter.
Hello and welcome to the Reefer Reporters here on LifestyleRadio.net. We are live and you are with News Hawks, Kim Cooper, and myself, L. Graham, as we bring you the previous week's Canadian and international cannabis news. This week is for May the 8th to May the 14th. 2018. How are we today, Kim?
I'm doing all right. Getting excited about event season approaching us all. Everything is happening all at once for the next several weeks.
Sure is. I bet you wish you could just fly down here for a few weeks.
I sure do. This is the time of the year I miss Toronto most.
Yeah.
It's event time. I mean, things are happening. People are getting together. Conversations are happening. Movers and shakers getting together. Plans are being made. I hate missing it. I really do.
I'm only a quarter of the way from the city compared to where you are, so...
Yeah.
And I still can't get to them all, but we try.
Yeah, we do. We try.
We try.
We try. Alrighty. Get to as many as we can. But yeah, of getting to stuff, let's get to the news because, man, there's a ton of it.
Oh, I know. I had like 20 tabs open when I got started this morning.
Yeah, hard to decide what we're going to talk about. But of course, we got to get started right off the bat with good old Canadian Senate.
Yeah, that's right. Well, we like to keep our listeners informed what's happening here in Canada. And one of the things that came up in the last week is that the Senate says, some of them at least say they could sit into the summer to pass the cannabis bills.
Yeah, they say they have an obligation as a Senate to deal with the legislation that's before us and before we take a summer break.
Correct. Yeah. And they're talking about not just one bill, but two bills. That's C-45 and Bill C-46. They'd like to have them both passed before the summer ends. But if they don't, they'll stick around. And who knows? There's two different bills. Bill C-45, the legalization, could be passed. And the Bill C-46, which is the driving end of things, may not.
Yeah, that's right. Because they are two separate bills, Trudeau's government especially, is really pushing for 45 to be, to be declared law and passed through the Senate so that it can become law. They don't seem quite so concerned about 46. They're saying, if you need more time on that, okay, we can look at giving you that, but just do 45 for sure.
Yeah, it almost makes you wonder... there may delay that drinking end of things. There is no standard set anywhere as far as THC in your blood system to say that you're impaired.
That's right. We've gone through this several times on several various shows that we're part of here on Lifestyle. The DREs that are in effect today, which determine whether or not you're impaired, I mean, they're ineffective. Medical tests that can be done, whether it be through saliva, blood, or otherwise, urine samples, and all of your bodily fluids, they're proven inconclusive. Not to mention people's tolerance levels are different. Just because you've consumed or you have it in your body does not prove impairment.
That's right, exactly. Just so you know that the Senate is squeezed for time. They got these two bills before the floor. They have to get them overdone in 6 weeks, and they are holding a vote. June 7th is going to be very important here in Ontario. We've got our Ontario provincial election on June the 7th, as well as we got the Senate, who is going to vote on this on June the 7th. And then, they're going to make amendments. It's going to happen for sure. And it's got to be sent back to the House of Commons, and they're going to have to whip it up really quick. If not, we're waiting for this thing to be voted on in September.
Yeah, and that's it. I mean, what amendments is it going to be passed on with the Senate? In all likelihood, it's going to be passed because there's huge pressure to make that happen. So in all likelihood, we are going to see it passed by the Senate. But like you say, with what amendments? And then with those amendments, what's the House going to do with that? Yeah. What's the Commons going to do with that when they get those amendments? They've then got to authorize those amendments and say, yes, we accept them. Or it's a big clusterfuck once again.
Yeah, for sure. And one of those amendments, moving on to our next story, could possibly, as some of them have requested, and that's banning home growing of cannabis.
Yeah, once again, the lovely Anne McClellan chiming in on this one, everybody's favorite politician when it comes to cannabis. She says that it can't happen. It's paternalistic, unenforceable, that you cannot ban home growing, and that was found through her task force.
And it's pretty obvious that they can't ban home growing. It's been going on constantly and growing stronger for the last 100 years when it's been illegal.
That's right. I mean, people are growing cannabis all across the country in their backyards, in their basements, and in their greenhouses. It makes sense to legalize it, put some limits on it that people can abide by and live with and make everybody happy, get your taxes off of it, loosen up the courts, and free up the police forces from, trying to enforce these insignificant laws.
Well, as you know, the bill will allow for a growing of 4 cannabis plants, but obviously, you know, the condo owners, municipalities, apartment owners are all, you know, sort of going against some of this, as well as Quebec and Manitoba has, you know, they don't even include it in their provincial end of things.
Yeah, the province is going against federal law. I think we've already seen the pushback from the feds on that. They're not going to stand idly by and allow that to happen. They say, no way, you can't override federal law in an individual province. As far as condo boards and all of that kind of thing, multi-dwelling units, you're talking about a whole bunch of uneducated people that are basing their decisions and their mindsets on propaganda that they have been fed for the last 80 years. It's been proven time and time again that it doesn't cause any more harm than your average house plant. So in order to ban that, you'd have to ban all plants, in my view.
Yeah, well, unfortunately, they're not looking at that. You know, it's a dangerous plant. Yeah. And actually, Anne McClellan goes on to say that she predicts that very few people actually grow inside because it's just so much easier to go down to the store and pick it up.
Yeah.
She sort of, compares alcohol. You know, people, it's easier for people to go buy beer than it is to produce it.
That's right. And she's got a point there, you know. Not everybody grows a vegetable garden. We all want organic veggies. We all want fresh produce in the summer. How many of us actually grow a garden? It's going to be the same thing with cannabis. Some people aren't green thumbs. They're not plant oriented. They don't have the time, space, technology, whatever the case may be. They're just not going to do it. I believe in this case, she's correct. A lot of people aren't going to jump on the bandwagon when I can just go to the store and buy it.
She says that people might be concerned about a few things, you know, fertilizers and pesticides that could come from somebody else's property under their plants and consume it. And she even mentions that she's worried that some people wouldn't grow their own because some dog may pee on it.
Well, once again, we go back to the original of Anne McClellan once again.
I don't know. I've smelled some stuff that smells like a cat.
I mean, every once in a while she says something smart and then we revert right back to good old Anne McClellan.
Yeah, exactly. Well, Dr. Mark Ware, he was also involved in this article here at CBC. And he says, you know, the technology is growing. It's not a lot of people thinking, oh, it's, you know, 4 big moldy old plants. But a lot of people buy those home boxes.
Yeah.
And it's all contained in this little spot. Like, I've had arguments with people on Facebook going, like, why do you need 10 pounds of cannabis when you're getting over 4 pounds per plant? And I say, well, how are you growing 2 pounds per plant in a home box?
Yeah, you're not doing it. That's not the numbers that you're getting out of a homegrown. You're talking about industrial grow and outdoor grows and with seasons of 9 and 10 months for your growing season down in California and places like that. That's not happening in places like Ontario, especially in the north.
No. Because you know, you got to look at is responsible people. You look at fact that, you know, in the Allard case, we've proven that medical patients can grow without damaging homes. Yep. So I don't see that changing. You know, my buddy, you know, he has a house. He's going to grow 4 plants. He's not going to go around and smash a bunch of holes and walls and floors and get the house all moldy. Like,
that's right. That's right. I mean, the whole thing is just ludicrous. And once again, it goes to the stigma behind the portrayal of the people that are using this plant is just horrendous. You know, I mean, they've got this image of us that we're all just, you know, terrible criminals and we're rotten people and going to destroy everything, you know, and that's the mindset of these people. And that's where their views are coming from. And that's sad.
Yeah, it is. It is. And it's, they just got to get educated. But unfortunately, some people are just set in their ways, and that's the way it's going to be.
Yeah, and it's truly sad. You know, the propaganda's got to stop. People got to get educated, and we've got to move on.
talking about moving on.
Yeah.
I see this week the government's let everybody know something that they didn't realize, and that was that CBD oil is off limits.
Yeah, it's under the Controlled Substances Act, CBD. Now, this was mind-blowing to me. As a cannabis activist, I've got to say, I was painfully unaware of this. I mean, we see hemp oil on the shelves of stores and think it's quite normal. It's hemp oil. Well, hemp oil contains CBD. Many hemp plants are high in CBD. So do LPs proprietarily own those as well?
I don't know. I know as a longtime advocate, you know, just like yourself, but I understood it as being under the Controlled Substances Act, but I never really questioned, you know, because it's just, you see it so common now.
Yeah. It's everywhere. I mean, it's CBD oil. It's proven it doesn't get you high. There's no euphoric effects to it whatsoever. There's no dangers. There is zero deaths. There's zero harm. Okay, we can dispute the medicinal effects all day long for one side to the other, saying there's enough research, there's not enough research. All of that aside, there's no harm. And there's no euphoria. So why is it controlled?
Well, see, they say here that CBD oil, which is widely available at head shops and online, well, you can almost get them. It's not just in head shops and online anymore.
Yeah, you get it in this corner store.
Yeah. Well, there was one company, Hempworks. They were, you know, selling this stuff, CBD oil. In their products, and they were informed that that was illegal.
Yeah, and following through on that, they have, since the CBC article, they have stopped their shipments to Canada with all of their products. They are no longer importing their products to come in Canada to become in compliance with Canadian law. But once again, through some research that Al and I did through the day here, their products are made from 100% hemp.
Yeah, Hempworks, it says it's hemp oil or it's hemp CBD that they're using, and they were quite surprised about this as everybody else. Yeah. So, and the government has issued a notice saying that anyone who has evidence that this product is being sold in Canada should provide this information to law enforcement.
I mean, this is crazy. Yeah. This is crazy. You know, LPs have come out and taken a stand that CBD oil is proprietary in Canada to the LPs because it is a controlled substance. You know, hemp is pretty much legal in Canada. How can a derivative from the hemp plant be illegal in this country in 2018? I think this is a law that many people will like myself were completely unaware of and we thought had evolved over time, but apparently it has not.
No, it doesn't. Well, you know, hemp itself, which is grown with a license here in Canada, like they're not even allowed to use the whole plant. They're only allowed to use certain parts. So you got part of a plant that's legal and part of the plant that's illegal.
I mean, how can that be? It's a plant that has no psychoactive properties. No harm has ever come to anybody using it. No deaths have ever been involved. I mean, we have poisonous plants with less regulation.
Well, yeah, I know. There are several of them out there.
You know, but, you can grow them in your front yard and do what you want with them, and that's okay.
Yeah, we're looking at it's almost as if there's two different types of oils here. Like when I go through this thing, this article here, this is like, you know, CBD is added to hand lotion versus a CBD oil that someone's taking as medication under the tongue with a, you know, eyedropper.
Right. Okay, now CBD that's added to hand lotion, it's still CBD.
Yeah, well, I know,
exactly.
You
have to proprietarily purchase that CBD from an LP.
Well, I guess we're going to have to find out over time.
I mean, how ridiculous is this? I mean, this law must be revisited immediately, I would think.
Okay, I'm just looking to see here. Actually, they say the hemp work CBD oil isn't even authorized to be sold in Canada.
Yeah. So there, I mean, it's just all over the map. The way we're demonizing and making this product and this plant and byproducts of this plant illegal is just outrageous. If a honey farmer made a high vitamin C strain, would it be proprietary to a pharmaceutical company? You know, because it's now a vitamin, so it has to be looked after by pharmaceuticals or something. I mean, it's just ridiculous. Hemp is legal to grow. Your byproducts from it should be legal.
Well, hey, obviously the whole hemp plant's not legal. I sent you the link.
we've been looking at it, and I'm astonished.
Now, part of it seemed to do with the claims behind the CBD or the claims, which haven't been proven in trials yet.
Yeah, okay, I get that. But, I mean, to put these kind of regulations on it because of false claims doesn't make any sense. You know, put disclaimers on it, whatever you've got to do. The only reason they're regulating it like this is to allow a foothold for the LPs to take over and corner the entire market for CBD, THC, and all derivatives thereof, as far as I can see.
Well,
this is an attempt to corner the market.
Microprocessors will be, microprocessors or cultivators, microcultivators will be able to produce hemp.
Yeah.
Maybe
so you've got to be registered with one of the LPs. So whether you're a micro producer or a large facility, you're still under the heading of an LP, so to speak.
Yeah, correct.
One of subdivisions, right? Mm-hmm. So they want to corner the market on it and get rid of it. Just like a lot of holistic doctors and holistic properties, holistic medicine is getting a bad shaft in Canada as well for doctors not being able to prescribe it. It's a terrible thing. It really is.
Yeah, well, unfortunately, we won't be able to settle this today.
No, we'll
never settle. I'm sure this will come back up in the news.
Oh, for sure.
Yes.
It'll be coming up on a regular basis.
Yes. And talking about bringing things back up in the news, our next story has to do with veterans.
Yeah.
And the fact that veterans who deal with PTSD are taking Ottawa to court over cuts to their medical cannabis funding.
Hooray, hooray, hooray for these veterans. I mean, this is fantastic. It's about time these people got together and took a stand against Ottawa for these cutbacks.
Yes, it is. Well, it seems like a bunch of New Brunswick veterans are going to take the Veterans Affairs Canada to court saying that they violated their rights when it reduced the amount of medical cannabis it would cover. That was when they chopped off like 70%. They went from 10 grams a day. Yeah, from 10 grams a day down to 3 grams.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. David Lutt, St. John's-based lawyer who is representing the plaintiffs, said they want to be compensated for enough cannabis to avoid resorting to prescription drugs to control symptoms of PTSD and other conditions.
Yeah, well, the lawsuit, which has yet to be filed, could also seek a declaration that Veteran Affairs must address the rights violation by restoring funding to its previous levels. So they want to go back to the 10 grams per day. And as we've covered, I think it was in our last reefer report, some veterans have actually taken their lives.
People are dying because of this cutback. People are taking their lives. It's the injustice has to stop. There's no limits on any other prescription drug. They'll give you opiates hand over fist, as many as you want. So why is there a limit on cannabis? It is once again senseless.
Yeah, it is. Now, there was also a process at the time for them to apply through their doctors to request an increase in coverage. And some of them did get that, but not all of them get that.
No, not everybody gets it. If everybody got it, then they wouldn't have had to cut back because everybody would just do that. And then it would be a fruitless effort. Yeah. So, I mean, obviously not everybody got it. So, I mean, this is more stress for these veterans. They have PTSD and you're causing them stress, which sets off their PTSD. Why would they do that?
Yeah, that's be like it'd be like Fabian Joseph says. Joseph. It was actually Mr. Keating, Jamie Keating. He says it'd be like if it was opiates. You know, you don't just stop opiate intake cold turkey.
That's right.
I'm not saying you have to. You know, wean even the veterans here. I'm sure even if they tried to wean them down, they still have problems because they're just not getting enough medication through the day.
Yeah. Well, the medication was alleviating the symptoms and not causing them to be impaired. Ron Forrest, a member warrant officer with PTSD living in Geary, New Brunswick, said going from pills to cannabis was like a night and day thing. When you're on pills, it takes the pain away, but you can't go anywhere because everybody thinks you're impaired. You don't have that with cannabis. So losing the cannabis, you're going back to an impaired state.
Yeah. Completely agree. Veteran Affairs has been spending $60 million on cannabis, but how much money did they save because they weren't having to buy prescription drugs?
That's right. Yeah, there's nowhere in the article does it mention that.
No. So we'll keep everybody updated on this court case as it goes through because it's obviously a benefit to the veterans and they deserve it.
Absolutely. Absolutely, for sure. And from veterans to banking. CIBC is getting on the bandwagon for giving a shout out to cannabis businesses.
Yes, they are. They have joined some of the other banks. There's not many, but they have joined with one of them. I'm just trying to see who it was, but I can't. And they have joined in, and they're going to start dealing with cannabis companies instead of telling them to go elsewhere, as they have been. Recently. Well, Bank of Montreal, they say here, is actually another institution that has started doing it besides the CIBC. Yeah,
they say that we believe that by 2020, the legal market for adult use cannabis will approach $6.5 billion in retail sales. For context, that is greater than the amount sold of spirits in this country and approaches the same scale as wine.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Well, and once the licensed producers got on the Toronto Stock Exchange, some of them are going into the New York Stock Exchange. How can they start ignoring them?
Yeah, this shout out from the CIBC means a lot in the cannabis industry. Many businesses have been rejected over the years by banks and had their accounts closed and faced all kinds of injustices by banks and had a problem with maintaining accounts. So having a major branch like this shout out and say, you know what, we're okay with dealing with cannabis is a big push in the right direction for that. Hopefully others will follow.
Big question is this only for large producers of cannabis or is this going to include the little guy who wants to open up the head shop?
Yeah, well, hopefully it'll be a bleed-off scenario. I can't see how you can allow one and disengage with another. It would be then at that point, it would be discrimination against the smaller business, I would think.
It sure would be. Sure would be. And talking about smaller businesses, we see in Ontario that the OCS, I got that right, correct?
Yeah.
It's going to start selling papers and bongs and everything in the head shops or in the OCS stores. So does that mean, like, you know, I don't know. It's just, you go into a beer store, you don't see a bunch of stuff being sold other than beer, do you?
Yeah, you don't buy wine store. Glasses at the wine store.
No,
you don't buy beer steins at the beer store. And the one big thing that nobody seems to be talking about in this that caught my eye right away, as well as a few others, and that's the fact that bongs and rolling papers and all of that stuff that's sold in head shops today around Canada are technically illegal.
Yeah.
Currently, we have on the books section 462.2 of the Criminal Code, which deems bong shops and head shops are still illegal in Canada. Ontario, every province in Canada is included in that. Some provinces have done waivers, so to speak. I don't know what the proper term is for that, but they've done adjustments to the law to allow for reading materials. So things like magazines and books are now allowed in like Kohl's and big department stores and that. So there was some adjustments done provincially to allow for that. But nothing was ever done for bongs. No. So technically these stores are illegal. So does that mean that the OCS is engaging in illegal activity?
I think bongs just come so normalized that people don't even think about it.
They still enforce that law in rural Canada across the country.
Yeah, there are people that have been busted. That's I can't argue there.
Within the last 3 years, we had one in Northern Ontario. The Tripping Daisy was taken down by the OPP under 462.2. Yeah. And now we've got the Ontario government going to do sales of the thing that this man was taken to court for and arrested.
Correct. Yes, exactly. That's what they're going to do. And when you compare it to the beer store, like, you know, does the beer store sell patio sets?
Yeah.
That you can sit around and enjoy the cold one on?
Yeah.
I guess they sell, well, they sell ice. They sell ice even at the beer store?
I don't think so. None of the ones that we have out here do. They sell beer. That's what they sell.
So they do sell beer, do they? Well, they do sell beer at the beer store, but ice.
Well, the ones up in Northern Ontario do not. I can tell you that. We don't have any large liquor stores or beer stores. We have the regular old corner beer store that still has the rollers where your case of beer comes out on the rollers on the side. Okay. That's our beer store. And our liquor store is, you know, got a, you know, a couple of aisles of shelves and a cold room that has a few cases of beer in it. That's it.
Yeah. So it'll be interesting to see what happens down the road.
Yeah.
I think they should just stay out of it, allow the small guy to, you know, have that business. The government doesn't need it. They got enough money they're making.
Yeah, absolutely. But first thing they should do is, you know, maybe strike the law. 462.2 should maybe come off the books before we go any further.
Well, hey, I tell you what, Kim, if they don't change it, I'm sure the police would be interested in a citizen's arrest.
top of that one.
Our premier is under arrest for selling bongs.
Yeah, that would be fun.
Okay, well, let's go on to our last story before we go to our break.
Okay, sounds good. We're going to talk a bit about impaired driving.
Yeah, it's got some impaired parts to it, I think, as far as this BC new law that they're coming up with.
Oh, God. BC, I'm scratching my head going, oh my God, my once beloved BC. I can see people moving out of that province in droves in the future with the plans that they have. Latest up on the bat is their driving laws. You know, if you get pulled over and you're suspected, you're going to go through a 12-step program. If you're convicted, then you mean you can go to jail and you can get a fine.
Yeah, and you know that it doesn't even, like, even without this swab thing, this sativa or saliva testing, even when it comes through, if it's what the federal government goes with, even if the guy, if the person shows positive for cannabis with that, they're still going to put them through all that 12-step program. It's going to it's going to tie up a couple officers each time that this goes on. It's not going to be a 5-minute job, I can tell you that much.
No, you're taken back to the station. You know, the police officers that take you there have to do all of their paperwork. A third guy that's called in that's trained as your DRE, he'll put you through the process. Well, now you've got three officers tied up for a number of hours on every individual that they pull over. This is going to be problematic at the onset. And how many times are they going to get it wrong?
Oh, I could just imagine how many times they're going to get it wrong. They had an interview with Vancouver-based lawyer Kayla Lee, who has challenged the roadside processing several times for the alcohol end of things. And she says with this cannabis end that it's going to be impossible for them to administer. You're going to have two different officers tied up for hours conducting these investigations. And she also took the drug recognition expert training course in December and says it's not very reliable and doesn't really pertain to cannabis impairment in any way. She says it's designed to make you fail it. And talking about that, so there's some places in the U.S., actually I think it's all the U.S. states, don't recognize drug recognition officers where our Supreme Court of Canada has.
Yeah, which is really disappointing. I mean, out in BC, even if a driver passes the drug test and is considered to be sober behind the wheel, the new law can still penalize them. It forbids consumption of any kind in any form by anyone inside the vehicle, whether you be the passenger or the driver. So passengers are included in this. Fines can range from $5,000 to $10,000, and you can get up to 6 months in jail.
Yes. Yeah. Can you just imagine that, being a passenger in a car? So it says right here, the legislation forbids any consumption of cannabis in any form by anyone inside a vehicle, whether a driver or a passenger. So you're going to be smoking a joint in a car. You could be sitting in the back seat and you could get 6 months in jail.
Yeah. Yeah. Look and now that. What about patients?
There's no
wording in this anywhere that says patients are exempt from this. It is worded in such a way that it encompasses everyone, and patients are not acknowledged in this. So as a patient in BC, if you are in a way, if you're having an anxiety attack, if you're having a PTSD issue and you need to consume your medication right now, if you're in a car, you can't.
You can't. You're facing 6 months in jail if you do.
Yeah. So you're going to go unmedicated and, you know, possibly have a mental breakdown or an issue. I know if I'm having a panic attack, I need my meds now, not in 10 minutes where we're out of the car.
Exactly. Exactly. Okay, Kim, it's break time.
Yes.
And after the break, you've got your Canada history moment. You want to give us a little tease on it?
Yeah. Well, how did we get started with all of this, and has it really changed much?
I don't know. We'll find out after the break. But before that, we're going to hear an old BBC news report on cannabis legalization in Uruguay. And as we return, Marlon Asher will let us know a little bit more about the ganja farmer. You're listening to the Reefer Reporters. We're live here at lifestyleradio.net.
Hey, this is Cheech.
And this is Chong.
And you're listening to
Lifestyle Radio.
What is it?
Lifestyle Radio. Say it one more time.
420 Radio?
Ooh.
You're listening to Lifestyle Radio.
It's the kind of thing that could land you in serious trouble in most countries. But here in Uruguay, growing, selling and consuming cannabis is now legal. The first country in the world to opt for full legalization.
This is Chocolate number 6, Chocolate. LA Confidential.
LA Confidential. The law allows a cannabis club to have as many as 99 plants of varying strengths and properties. And supporters deny charges it'll boost the illegal trade in drugs. Quite the opposite.
The best way of fighting crime is this, you know, attacking the business, not the people who consumes, not the user or the grower. You need to attack the business in taking customers away from crime.
Supporters say this is much more than a hippie's charter, a license to get high. Uruguay is now in a unique position to develop and exploit the commercial and medicinal uses of cannabis as well. Just across the border in Brazil, Margarete Brito is frustrated. She knows that cannabis extract, or CBD, helps cut the number of Sofia's epileptic attacks. But getting hold of CBD isn't easy, and is certainly no off-the-shelf remedy.
I'm always trying to find people who are traveling so that they can bring it in for me. And when I can't get hold of it, we have to find a courier.
What's in here is a dilution of 3 parts olive oil to 1 part cannabinoid oil.
Even in some U.S. states like Colorado, where cannabis is legal, federal law prohibits medical trials with a drug. So some producers are here in Uruguay.
Once we move beyond anecdotal evidence through the clinical trials about to happen in Uruguay, everything that happens here is going to be watched very carefully by other countries, and I believe they will follow suit if good results are found.
By awarding licenses to 2 companies to grow cannabis commercially, Uruguay's radical marijuana legislation is now almost complete. New businesses are growing, and in addition to medical trials, tax revenues could be worth millions. Many other countries are keeping a close eye on Uruguay's controversial experiment with weed. Wira Davis, BBC News, Montevideo.
Are you looking for cannabis news, education, and people's opinions? Are you looking to learn what Canadian and international cannabis advocates are doing? Not only now, but what got them to this point in their lives, and what does the future hold for them? Do you want to learn how patients are using cannabis as their daily medication, or learn how their cannabis use helps them with their medical condition? If you answered yes to any of these questions, then I'm going to suggest to you to tune in to Lifestyle Radio. Catch their live weekly shows and have your questions and concerns answered and find the experience you're looking for. Monday, catch your weekly news broadcast with the Reef Reporters. Then on Wednesday, get several hours worth of cannabis public education. We get things started with cannabis and coffee with Tamarijuana. Then tune in and catch Pottawa with Russell Barth, who calls himself the world's angriest pothead. Finish up your evening with the award-winning Pace Radio Show with Al Graham and joint host Kim Cooper and Alicia Yashishin. No week would be complete without tuning into Friday night's program, the 420 Radio Show, featuring Al Rapp and the 420 Radio crew, Mary Jane Baker and Marcel Gignac. Cannabis is a lifestyle, and you can catch all your cannabis lifestyle information right here at lifestyleradio.net or at our sister site, 420radio.ca.
Come and say ganja, 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 ganja. If you don't want to call it, don't call it sensaminia. If you don't want to call it, don't call it marijuana. If you don't want to call it, don't call it the indica. And from me bonnet in a chalice and rush it a paper. Lord, see me love me ganja. Some ganja planter. Call me the ganja farmer. Deep down in the earth, see me put the ganja. Babylon, come on.
Oh, we're back from our session. Before we get back to the news, it's time for Kim's Canada History Moment. Go ahead, Kim. What do we got for today?
I got a love live radio. Today we're going to go back in time, not too far, but at the same time, right up to the beginning. I'm talking about a story that was published back in 2014, happened to pop up in my social media news feed and remind me of me publishing this a while back. It was a story that was Huffington Post, in the Huffington Post, about the start of prohibition and how we got to where we are. It discusses all Anslinger and, you know, the start of prohibition and how it was a racist war from the start. When you look forward through cannabis history, from the start when Anslinger started all of this and the prohibitionist times that we faced and the stigma against races back then that was faced back then, not much has changed over the years. We can look towards a study that was published in 2016 that is quoted in saying that it causes, you know, people of color to be more promiscuous and for women to be more promiscuous when it's used. So it's astonishing to me that this stigma has continued for so long that's been associated with this plant.
Yeah, well, one of the quotes from Anslinger from back then, which I actually had put on a T-shirt, says that this marijuana causes white women to seek sexual relations with Negroes, entertainers, and any others. Like, what the?
Yeah, he also went on to say that reefer makes darkies think they're as good as white men.
Like, if this law wasn't based on racism, I don't know. Like, this is just... It's ridiculous.
Yeah, it is. It really and truly is. And when you think about the basis of all of this, how can we be maintaining a stance of prohibition today in 2018? The racism and the stigma around this plant continues after almost a century now.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. And it's still going on. Still going on. It's unfortunate. No need for it.
Absolutely not. So it's a bit of a wake-up call, you know, to let people know. Do a little bit of history search. Find out how this started. Look up Harry Anslinger and look up his reasons for starting prohibition against cannabis. And think about all of the propaganda that we've been facing for the last 85 years since he did that and where it comes from and the basis for it.
Yeah.
How can we maintain a stance on prohibition today based on that?
And the thing is that this guy was in the federal government in the same position for like 30 years, 35 years through different administrations. He never lost his job. Nobody else ever went in there.
No, he maintained his superiority and his stand, and he got paid off by all of the big corporations that were making money by the illegality of cannabis, which in turn made hemp illegal in the United States and Canada for a very long time as well. You know, the DuPonts of the world and, you know, the Hearsts of the world were the profiteers, and Mr. Anslinger was paid handsomely for his work.
Sure was. Talking about paying and buying, let's move on to our next round of stories.
Yeah, we're going to talk about buying cannabis once it's legal in Vancouver with the dispensary situation they have over there.
Yes, I see the city councilor, Melissa Giovanna. I messed up that name. she plans to introduce a motion to require dispensaries in Vancouver to carry cannabis grown by federal licensed producers.
Well, once again, gotta leave it to the government for doing something that's not legal to start with. Think somebody better tell Miss Genova over there that LPs aren't allowed to sell to dispensaries to start with. That's illegal federally.
Yeah, because the dispensaries in Vancouver are governed, they're legal under their jurisdiction, but not by the federal government. So, yeah.
Correct. They are not allowed to sell to a dispensary in Vancouver. And if they do, they're breaking the law. So, on its face, Ms. Genova needs to do some research.
Yeah, well, she's upset that, you know, it's funding organized crime and gangs and stuff like that. And it puts patients at risk. and the public at risk. So her motion has been seconded.
Yeah, well, it's been seconded, but hopefully somebody in the Vancouver jurisdiction there will be able to wake these people up and let them know that what they're trying to mandate won't happen on a federal level, because they're asking for the LPs to break the law as it's written federally. So there's no way the LPs are going to climb on board with their mandate.
Well, it says here that the motion resolves that city council direct staff to require all cannabis-related businesses in Vancouver to provide the city with an annual audited financial statement. So that's all cannabis businesses. This overtakes more than just dispensaries.
Yeah, for sure. All cannabis-related businesses. Well, now you're talking about head shops, what we were just talking about a minute ago, which, again, once again, are technically illegal under 462.2. So, I mean, somebody really needs to educate the Vancouver city councilors on laws before they try and mandate these ludicrous freaking laws in their city.
I see that the councilor... her husband is a member of the Vancouver Police Department.
There you go. Enough said.
it's an article by Straight Cannabis, Amanda Siebert. She wrote it, and it'd be interesting. It's interesting to see if that's what happens, because right now it'd be basically like, I guess if you look at. Insight. It's a place where people consume, consume illegal drugs there. Whereas people purchase illegal drugs at dispensaries. It's sort of opposite, but the same supplier is, this is the black market.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting. You know, the connection with the Vancouver PD is quite ironic there, and it kind of speaks for the councillor. Vancouver PD has been extremely busy once again with some raids over there, which brings us to our next story.
Yeah, over there on the island, lots going on. Cannabis edible company have been raided by the police force.
Yeah, there's been a lot of speculation about this over the past week or so prior to the announcement in the newspapers that we've gotten a hold of. A lot of people love this company, Moda, friend to one and all can in the cannabis community, has indeed been raided. There's been some, suspicious activity by the Vancouver Police Department out front of their factory, and it has been confirmed that they have indeed been raided.
And the people within the same building where these edibles were being made, they didn't even know they were there. So how could they have been a problem to anybody?
Nobody even knew they were there. They operated in a small corner and occupied the same space that was boarded off, but they were never an issue. Nobody even knew they were there. Police were bored taking everything out and confiscating all of their material. And others in the unit were like, what are you talking about? That's a cannabis company? No way. I don't believe.
Well, some of the comments that were posted on Facebook suggest that the raid was initiated by the Vancouver Island Health Authority because the city of Victoria banned the sale of edible products.
Yeah, so police pushback once again. To me, it all goes back to the government trying to control the market. They're coming down with their legalization platform, and they're trying to put all small businesses that are currently operating that pushed this legalization platform forward. We're trying to put them all out of business and leave it to the big boys.
Yeah, and the edible end isn't even going to be legalized for over another year still. So
they say within 12 months of regular legalization of flower material.
Correct. Well, going from one thing that we are curious how it's going to be implemented with these dispensaries and buying cannabis from licensed producers when it's against the law, our next story is also sort of a similar idea behind that, is that a township is demanding from Health Canada that they receive notification that where the medical cannabis gardens are in their county.
Yeah, we're not talking about LP production here.
No.
We're talking about you, me, as patients, you know, anybody that has their right to grow. If you've applied for your right to grow as a patient, then the North Dundas Association feels they have the right to know about that.
Yeah, well, they say that personally licensed medical cannabis growers are damaging their homes, potentially turning them into moldy and unhealthy fire hazards, legally stuffed with hundreds of plants.
Oh, and when, once again, where are these people getting their information from?
From the news.
You know, question your sources, people. Do some freaking research. I mean, any patient that is growing for their medicinal use is doing so by complying with all of your business codes, because if we've got mold, our plants are going moldy. We don't want mold.
Correct. Exactly. And they don't, they use the evidence of large grow ops for gangs to say that this is what medical cannabis patients are like. And this has all been debunked in the courts.
Yeah, Allard did this. We've done this in Allard. We've proven it in the courts. I don't know why people listen to propaganda. And that's all it is more propaganda, people and demonizing people that use this plant. Base your judgments on science and facts and not crap.
Well, according to the township planning director, Calvin Poole, he told council, they're supposed to notify us when they apply, and they're supposed to notify us when they get a license. Like, what?
I own my house. Why do I have to tell you anything that I'm doing?
We don't have to tell them any of that stuff.
No. No. I don't have to tell them if I put up a small greenhouse to grow my tomatoes. I don't have to tell them if I'm growing cannabis either.
Well, he's suggesting that people aren't doing this and it's supposed to happen, but completely wrong.
Yeah, we're all, once again, misinformed. Nowhere in any legislation does it say that we are deemed to let our township know what we're doing.
Yeah, exactly. They say that license applications ought to be circulated to municipalities for comment.
I mean, it's just ludicrous. The whole thing is just mind-boggling that this kind of mentality still exists in 2018.
They believe that Health Canada should put a cap on the number of plants grown in homes. Yeah, number of plants grown in a home. I almost thought they said the number of homes within the township or the county, and I went, what? But yeah, cap the number of plants. Go ahead. Allergies. It's allergy season.
Allergy season is upon us, and I'm allergic to bullshit. Sorry. I mean, I'm just going to say that I'm allergic to bullshit, and I really have to move on before I get too congested.
This counselor is worried that they're the only ones being ignored. No. This has been tried in other places.
Yeah.
It's a complete medical privacy issue.
It's none of your damn business what my doctor prescribes me or how I go about filling my prescription.
What was that?
It's none of anybody's business what my doctor prescribes me or how I go about filling my prescription.
They don't need to know.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do they know everybody that's on prescription drugs? No.
No.
No. All right. Let's get away from Canada. Let's head south.
Sounds good. Go down into the United States, where a lot is going on in individual states down there.
Yeah, they are. And it's also rubbing off onto some of the people within that make up the laws, the lawmakers.
Yeah.
Getting their attention.
Yeah, federal policymakers are getting in on the game, at least on the Democratic side.
Sure are. And in Illinois, there's 8 Democrats running for attorney general, and all they've endorsed cannabis legalization.
Yeah, all 8 of them.
Yeah, Yeah, sort of the top three Democratic candidates for governor also.
Yeah, so I mean, that's fantastic to see that they're looking at this now and they're saying, okay, you know what, maybe we were wrong. We can revisit this.
Yep, so it would be interesting if they can get enough of them and if they ever get in control, you know, maybe they can make a change here and get it out of schedule one drug.
Yeah, I think the biggest surprise is 84-year-old California Senator Dianne Feinstein, a longtime proponent of legalization, reversed her position last week.
Yes, yeah. So there you go, 84 years of age, and you can still change your mind on the cannabis position.
Yeah, so, I mean, the trend is happening. It's just, it's slow.
Yes, it is. And, you know, it's not just, you know, the Democrats are coming out maybe more on this, but there have been some Republicans, and you would need, you know, probably votes from both sides, depending on what the percentages are in the House. But there are some Republicans that are for it. So.
Yeah, well, hopefully we can get more for than against and see some major changes happen in the U.S., hopefully in the near future. Yeah. You know, senators are coming out, and they're not the only ones. Doctors are starting to speak out a little bit, too.
Yes, they are, and they're doing that even though that they don't have, you know, the studies that some doctors are really looking for. Doctors are starting to prescribe it.
Yeah, they're saying, well, you know, we don't necessarily have all the information, but anecdotal information is out there and patient success stories. So, We're for prescribing it if it's a possibility of working.
Yeah, well, 7 out of 10 oncologists surveyed in the United States say that they aren't informed enough about the risk and benefits. But 8 out of 10 doctors said that they discussed medical cannabis with their patients in the last year, and almost 50% of them have gone as far as recommending it. So that's, you know, 50%. That's, you know, it's not everybody, but that's a lot more than what's been going on.
That's for sure. I mean, it's a huge increase compared to, you know, was like, you know, 1 or 2% not too long ago. So those are big numbers coming out. Encouraging to see. We're definitely not there yet. But, you know, the scales are starting to tip.
Yes, it is. They did a survey of some oncologists, and the responses revealed that 30% of the cancer doctors felt significantly informed to make recommendations, but 46% recommended its use regardless. And of those who recommended its use, 56% admitted that they did not consider themselves well informed enough to do so, but yet they still did it.
Yeah. Yeah. They said patients with weak immune systems that were wreaked by chemotherapy could be at risk of fungal infection from pot use, she noticed. So that was one of their concerns. But the report found conclusive evidence that oral medications containing THC, the intoxicating chemical in pot, can reduce the impact of chemotherapy-induced nausea and vomiting.
Which is obviously, nobody wants to keep throwing up when you're sick.
That's it. Yeah. That's it.
So, you know, they're probably seeing a lot of anecdotal evidence. Maybe they're not seeing it in writing, but, you know, when you can see a difference in a person after using cannabis, whether you believe in it or not, it can really make a big change.
And if it's not causing any harm, then what is the harm in allowing it to happen?
Exactly. They're not, you know, they're hearing the other patients are benefiting from it. They're not hearing about any negative, nasty effects.
Yeah.
Unlike other ways of doing things, such as chemo.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. You know, the adverse effects just are not materializing.
Yeah.
So they definitely, the benefits outweigh the risks at that point.
Yep, exactly. So allow your cancer patients access to cannabis.
For sure.
And talking about, you know, the numbers are growing in the doctors, but not only are doctors signing more on the oncologist end of things, but also there's more jobs as well going on in the States.
Yeah, in every sector you can think of, job numbers in the cannabis industry are growing faster than in any other field, according to CEO of a leading company that connects businesses with employees.
445% job growth in job listings in the category year after year is what they say in the U.S. News and World Report.
Yeah, they say put to that the perspective, he added that tech positions are at 245% growth and healthcare jobs are up 70%. So that's a big increase over those industries.
Oh, big time, big time. Let's see. In L.A., yeah, L.A., is their jobs have increased. They're not the only one. San Francisco comes in at number two with the cannabis job list. San Jose, number eight. There's lots of high numbers as far as those being the top jobs out there. Seattle, Denver, Oregon, they're all taking the top 10 spots.
Yeah, even places like Florida is at number 10, and Florida is still only legal for medicinal use there. U.S. cannabis industry employs between 165,000 and 230,000 full and part-time workers.
Yeah, you know, I know it's the U.S., and I would think that they still pay income tax, so is the federal government. Federal government is taking taxes from these employees at a job that they classify as an illegal substance.
Yeah, that's right. So, you know, you're getting tax dollars, which is paying for education, schools, buildings, roads, healthcare, everything else that your tax dollars go to. And it's coming from a federally illegal product. Really time for stuff to change.
Yeah. It's time for the government to get caught up with everybody else because there's a huge industry that's just coming through, and if you're not going to allow it, they're just going to knock down the door.
That's it. I mean, there's no end in sight. The workforce trends are forecasting upwards in every aspect, in every genre, and it's all cannabis related. So the jobs are there, and you know, the prosperity is there for the taking. We've just got to make sure that we do this right.
That's right. Talking about jobs, cannabis creates jobs in all kinds of industry, and I would never thought about this happening in our last story.
Yeah, I love this one. What do you use CBD in, right? Okay, we're talking about CBD at the start of the show and how it's a legal product under the law, still under controlled substance. We put in our lotions, potions, and our creams and gels, all kinds of stuff. How about we put it in our makeup, ladies? CBD, cannabis-infused CBD makeup made instead of using beeswax. What do you think, Al?
Well, I don't use mascara, but to me, to see it on somebody, I may not know any difference. I would look more of it as a health benefit, and I'm not even looking at it as a CBD end of parts of things, because I'm looking at it because you're always hearing about makeup can be bad for you. It's being tested on animals. What kind of effects does it have on us, on the human body? But yet with CBD in it, could it be something that counteracts these negative effects and be a huge benefit?
Better for you, right? I mean, it's plant-based, so it has a vegan appeal. There's a lot of people out there that are vegans, you know, and vegetarians and all that kind of stuff. And like you say, they don't want to use, you know, animal-based products. They're concerned about, you know, testing on animals and all that kind of stuff. So this kind of addresses all of that by being vegan by nature and containing cannabidiol CBD. You know, I mean, that's fantastic. This place is called Kush Mascara. They're looking to branch out into the industry. And this article is coming to us from Civilized.
Yeah, take a look at that. I've never ever heard of CBD mascara, so.
CBD mascara coming to you from Kush Mascara. So, you know, check out for a product near you, I guess, in the near future. I know I'll be looking for it.
Okay, good. Good. You can let us know when you're wearing some. Let us know how it feels.
Will do. Will do.
Calm your eyes. You'll fall asleep. Okay, Kim. That's it, eh? We got all the stories covered.
We did. We got them all covered this week. There was a lot of them. We cut a lot out. We wanted to do more, but just not enough time.
Yeah, yeah. It's hard to cover, you know, 35 to 40 stories.
Yeah. So.
Okay, well, that's our Reefer Report for May the 6th to the 14th, 2018. And in closing, we'd like to say thank you for listening to our cannabis broadcast here at Lifestyle Radio. If you enjoyed it, please share it with your friends. And also let them know that they can usually catch us Mondays around 4:20. And don't forget to educate, medicate, and do not incarcerate.
I'll catch you later.
So what are you doing?
Nothing.
Nothing? Why not?
I'm trying to get on this Lifestyle Radio website.
Sounds like a cool website.
Yeah, it's all right. Oh, I might have it.
You might have it.
You're listening to Lifestyle Radio.
The opinions expressed during this show are those of the individual participants and do not necessarily reflect the opinions of their associated organizations or Lifestyle Radio.